All right, welcome back. And this is going to be the latest thing we're going to take a look at. This is a Pioneer PD-DM802 12 disc compact disc player, obviously using Pioneer's magazine style loading. And this comes to me from a new customer that was referred to me. And only thing I know about it is one of the magazines is stuck, or there's a disc stuck from one of the magazines and it won't come out. So we're gonna be opening it up, having a look at how they did things. I've always been a huge fan of these type of machines, primarily just because of the fact the optics are hanging upside down. So it's looking at the disc from the top down. So if you own one of these, chances are you never needed any routine cleaning, because there is never an instance for dust to settle on the lens because the lens is upside down. So we'll come in, as always, have a look at the front controls and then have a look at the inside to see if we can find out what's working and what's not working. So give me a second for that and we'll get started with this. Alright, coming back in, let's have a look at the front panel controls. Left side, obviously power button, followed by the random button. You can have the computer pick out a disc and a song for you, followed by highlight scan, I believe. That just gives you the first few seconds of each song, so you can kind of preview your music if you want. Disc magazine eject 1 and 2 for the two magazines, followed by the direct access to the two magazines. Basically, if you're listening to magazine 1 and you want to go immediately to magazine 2, you just push that button and it'll take you right to the disc in that magazine. Fader button, very handy for fading a song out while recording onto a cassette or other media. Followed by the six disc access buttons, so you can go to a specific disc in the magazine. Direct track entry here, and at this point we had surpassed plus 10 and they added a plus 20 in case you found yourself with a disc with 22 songs on it. You could have instant access to the 22nd song. Program and delete for setting it up to program the songs you want to hear in any particular order. Up top here we have, looks like ADLC, which I believe is automatic digital level control, where basically you can attenuate the output signal going into your receiver if you want to. Repeat time and edit, all more programming features, and give you a phone, headphone jack, and a level control. Followed by the disc operation controls, play, pause, stop, track advanced forward, track advanced back, and that's a shared button with time skip. If you just hold it down, I'm sure it advances you through the seconds of the current song you're listening to. Coming up over the top, got the lid removed, and we're looking at the mechanism of this. And if I am not mistaken, this is probably the last version of optical pickup they used in these type of machines. And don't know that for a fact, but I'm pretty sure that that's the case. One thing for sure is at this point they had upgraded all of these flex cables. These started out with a white, stiffer flex cable for the optical pickup, but of course as that mechanism moves up and down, the cable flexes back and forth, and they figured out after a while that it would develop an intermittent connection, and so they switched it over to this thinner brown film type cable. And of course, you've got some motors here. Slide your disc in and out, raise your elevator up and down, and this may be the one for the clamp to clamp onto the disc. Over here, we got just a very streamlined setup in the circuitry. Transformer mounted to the bottom of the unit, but soldered on to the main circuit board, followed by, I believe, they went to a surface mount systems control, or that could be servo. And then, of course, a Pioneer D to A converter should be right here. Yeah, pulse flow D to A converter. And then a few op amps, 4558s, in the output side of this. Yep. Not a ton of supporting circuitry. This should be a motor controller, I see. LA6520, I believe that's what that is. Yeah, very nice. By the time we got to this point in the early 90s, kind of already gotten everything hammered out pretty good. And so everything was pretty streamlined. So, all right, so the next thing we'll do, let's hook it up and find out what will work and what won't work. So give me a second for that, and we'll come back. All right, coming back with the unit plugged in, and we do get our display to come up on the unit. One thing I noticed right away was there was a motor in the back moaning and making some noise. So I'm not sure exactly what's happening, but let's see what we get here. Can hear it struggling. Oh, it gave us that one anyway. But I still hear it doing something. Let's try the second one. Not getting nothing. One thing I did notice, though, is it's probably impossible to pick it up with a camera, but right down in between there, you can tell that there's a disc that's partially out of the magazine. And I don't know if the disc has went over the lip of the tray that it's sitting in, and that's why it's stuck. Not sure, but it certainly doesn't want to do anything, that's for sure. All right, let's do this. Let's see if we can get down inside there, maybe. You can't see it with the camera, but we need to get right down in there and see if we can. I'm going to unplug it, and we'll see if we can push that disc back in the tray. I can see it, but I don't want to screw the disc up. Quite reach it with that. Let's see what happens now. Still groaning. Oh, there it goes. Maybe. not. Let's see if it tried to pull it back out again. It may have tried to pull it back out again. No, it didn't try to pull it back out, but you can see that the tray is still stuck. All right, how about this? See if we can manually get that tray to magazine to eject. And I think we're right back where we started from. I can see the disc, the edge of the disc. And again, trying to be super careful not to damage the disc or the mechanism. We don't want to bend anything in the mechanism, so. What I'm attempting to do is pull it from the front, and you can tell that there is something stuck. I'm not sure if one of the trays is went wacky inside the magazine. But I'm going to pause here and let me see if I can meticulously remove this without damaging anything, and then we'll come back and see what we found out. All right, picking back up with the mechanism completely removed from the unit now, just to get a better view of what might be happening. And you can see down inside there, I don't know how well I can pick it up on camera here, but you can see that there's one tray in that magazine that is kind of wedged. Yeah, you're not going to be able to see that. Maybe through this way. Now there's one tray that's wedged that's causing the problem. So what I'm going to attempt to do is I'm going to attempt to push it from down in there and see if I can get it freed up. Didn't want to do anything too evasive with it inside the unit without a, don't want to start bending that metal. Once you start bending that metal of all these things that move, you know, against each other, then all of a sudden you're going to have a big problem on your hands. So. There it is. So now what we want to do is we want to throw it back in there. We'll set this magazine off to the side and we're going to try the top magazine that had no trouble coming out. And for this magazine, it was the actual, you can see what's going on here, right here. You sure can. When it went to put it back in there, it just didn't drop it in the tray the right way. But don't be misled in thinking that these don't go bad. These magazines do go bad. All right, let me go ahead and slip this mechanism back inside the unit, and let's hook it up and see if it resets and see if it will take the known good magazine and play it in the bottom slot, the one that had the magazine stuck in it. So give me a second for that. All right, picking back up, got the mechanism set back in the unit. I didn't screw anything down. I just got all the wiring hooked back up just so we can give it a test try here. This is the magazine that was in the top slot that didn't have any trouble coming out. So let's slide this into the bottom. This is in the bottom slot. And let's see what happens here. Elevator goes down, loads the disc up, and reads it. Yes. It does. Let's see if it'll eject. No problem. Popped it right out. Now, we'll take the suspected bad magazine and do the same thing. Let's put that in there. Okay. Loads that up. Plays it. Let's try to eject. No, it popped it back out. Let's try that again. I don't know. Popped it out. I don't know. Seems like there's something still kind of funny about that. So play around with it a little bit more. And it stuck right there. It sure did. Okay, so let's see. Let's turn it off. Unplug it. We might be able to get it to actually go back. Maybe. Maybe not. There it goes. It popped it out. All right, so just to make sure it's not a fluke, we'll put the good magazine in. And we'll see. Okay. It's working every time on that one. No, pops it out every time. Let's try the bad magazine in the top slot. If we can get this bad magazine to get stuck in the top one, then we'll know we got something. But first thing I have to do is the flip door. I didn't raise up the flip door when I stuck the mechanism back in it, so I'm gonna have to do that now. Yeah, if you don't get those flip doors timed right, then you'll have trouble as well. So, all right, let's hook it back up. And we're going to try the defective magazine in the top slot and see what happens. Something's going on here. I'm not sure what. Oh, we got a plug that's loose. Let's unplug. Replug in our plug. Give it another shot here. Let's see. And it's stuck again on the top slot, so that's pretty much confirmation that there's an issue with the magazine. Yeah, there's got something going on with that magazine. Like I said, don't be fooled into thinking that these magazines don't go bad. Those trays will warp. And when they warp, it will not work the correct way. Got it out. So I think we're going to chalk that up to the magazine being the issue. Put the good magazine in the top slot. Spins it over, table of contents, and play. Let's hook up the unit to the bench receiver. Let's see what we get here. BB King, Eric Clapton. Yeah, that's what this is. All right, disc two.
A sentimental fool.
Rod Stewart, next disc. This is Cheap Trick, I believe. Yeah, that's Cheap Trick. Next disc. Bill Collins. Greatest Hits, Bill Collins. Next disc. Eagles. It's also Greatest Hits, maybe? Yeah, Greatest Hits. Very nice. Well, I think we got a definite confirmed bad tray in our magazine over here. Let's see, what are we listening to here? Natalie Cole. Okay. I don't know, man. It's hard. It's always hard to tell, but all it needs to be is just slightly warped or some of the plastic just slightly misformed, and when it's time for that thing to slide that back inside there, it just hits and doesn't catch right. So it's very possible that there's something not quite right about it. But these things are still readily available. And you can see there's a little age on it for sure. And so it shouldn't be an issue to get it replaced. But at this point, I think we've seen it fail enough to confirm that that's what it is. Is there anything in here we want to hear? Let's see. What was this one? Big Bad, what? I don't know what that is. Let's see what this is. More Rod Stewart. Come on. More Rod Stewart. Big Rod Stewart fan. But where is the Rod Stewart A Night on the Town album? Where is Rod Stewart from Maggie May days? That's what we want to hear. All right, so pops this out. No trouble. I still got to work on the flip door. I didn't quite get it in the right place, but we'll get that fixed. So let me go ahead and get this put back correctly, mounted in the mechanism the way it's supposed to be, or mounted in the chassis the way it's supposed to be. And I think we can do a final play test on this. Looks like just a bad magazine. So let me get finished with that and we'll come back. All right, picking back up real quick. I did go ahead and remove the front mast from the unit. The display was bothering me a little bit, just wasn't bright, and so kind of as predicted, there's a pretty good haze of dust there that's going to need to be mopped up, and we'll clean off the fluorescent tube, and that should greatly improve the display on the front that you can see. Second thing is that this top flip door has a little tab right here, and as it's coming up into the top slot for the magazine, it was catching just a little bit right there, and that also probably a sign of the plastic being misformed. And so what I've done is just took a file and kind of file that down just a little bit so it will no longer rub right there. So just a few little bits and pieces, odds and end things to make this work a little bit better. So all right, we'll finish this up and then do our final play test. All right, picking back up, or finishing up with the PD-DM802 player. Got the front mast put back on. Definitely improved our display. It's still not factory perfect, and it's never going to be. Basically, what we have is just a weakened tube. This is no different than the picture tube in an old CRT-style television. The more that thing burns, the less bright it will become. And that's kind of where we're at with that. But you can still see it pretty well. It's a pretty bright room, but you can still see it if you're down close to it, to where you can get all the information you need as far as the track and stuff is concerned. Got the slots nice and springy the way they're supposed to be, no sticking. And a couple other things I did to this outside the video. I did remove the optical pickup assembly and flip it over so I could have a look at the lens of the laser. Very common with a lot of these pioneers from around this era was the glue that they used to hold the lens into the optical pickup. That glue would come loose and the lens would just fall out. And so I wanted to do a little bit of a stress test there just to make sure that there wasn't an issue with that. And that still seems to be very intact, so didn't mess with anything like that. Another notable problem across quite a few series of Pioneer CD players is the spindle motor going bad. And in this one, I put a little lubricant in it. It still spun very freely. There was no hesitation, so I don't think there's anything going on with that at all. But just for little preventive maintenance, I put a little lubrication in it just to be on the safe side. So at the end of the day, it looks like we had a defective magazine caught in one of the slots that hold the magazine. The tray was kind of wedged there, and of course the motor is not going to pull that back inside with it being wedged like that. So as far as the final playtest, we started the video out with a little Don Dawkins solo material. So only fair, we do a little bit of George's album here. So we'll do a little bit of that on the way out. We'll do track 2. It's a very good one to listen to. Then we'll fade it out and we'll be done. Thank you guys for hanging out and checking out the video on the Pioneer multi-disc player here. And if you find yourself with one of these units with a stuck magazine, it could be as simple as just the magazine being bad. So don't overlook the easiest thing. Until next time, thank you, and catch you later.